Hey there, hi, how are you? I'm the Geek with the Gab, wishing each and every one of you out there a happy Halloween. I love Halloween. From the decorations, to the candy, to the movies, I just can't get enough of it. Well, not technically Halloween movies per se, nothing gets me in the mood quite like a little bit of Hellraiser, Texas Chainsaw Massacre, and Nightmare on Elm Street. So I figured today I'd take a look at a movie that, despite limited budget, got some surprisingly solid reviews. I meant solidly good. Not a bad idea, but no. Guys, my grandmother watches this show, so we're gonna say no to Hellraiser, alright? Now I'm talking about the ultra-low budget 80s classic. We're gonna take a look at Sam Raimi's Evil Dead. We open on a group of college students on their way to shady lodgings in the middle of the woods.
We're five college students on our way to an old abandoned cabin in the woods.
Problems arise though as a super spooky force jerks the wheel out of one of our hapless victim's hands. At events so terrifying, Shelley strikes a pose up against the glass.
The acting doesn't get much better from here on out, I'm sorry to say.
They arrive at the cabin to find a sinister porch swing.
Truly the height of horror.
Neither of these are ever alluded to again either. They're just here to lend kind of a vaguely spooky mood. After unpacking, Cheryl kicks back to sketch the clock for some reason, when an unseen force stops the clock, then seizes control of her hand, sketching a book with Gary Oldman's face from Hannibal? Whatever, it doesn't matter, as this mysterious artistic event is never mentioned again, either.
At least we're, like, circling in on the proper plot here.
Right after a little drinky-poo. They sit around getting buzzed until the trap door to the basement flies open, totally on its own, without a hand pushing it up or anything. After some debating, the two manly men investigate, with Ash, played by a dapper young Bruce Campbell, clearly not ducking out of frame to compensate for the fact that there was no actual basement on set. Downstairs, our intrepid heroes find a bunch of satanic-looking artifacts, including a book that looks suspiciously like the one Cheryl accidentally sketched earlier, complete with a nice little drawing of that William Blake painting from Red Dragon, and a big friggin' knife with a skull on it. So, being the horror movie characters they are, they take all of this plus the gun and tape recorder upstairs, leaving all the items not essential to the plot where they are. Back upstairs with the super realistic looking lightning, everyone seems to be over the mysterious opening door and the creepy artifacts, and are back to goofing off, like the college kids they are. That is, until Ash gets the tape recorder working and plays what's left on it. This happens to be a recording of a professor who identifies the book as the Book of the Dead, bound in human flesh, and inked in human blood. Cheryl, being the voice of reason, shuts the damn thing off.
I personally would have gone the route of hopping in the car and driving until I found civilization upon figuring out I was in a house with the friggin' Book of the Dead, but that's just me.
Scotty, being that douche nugget we all knew in college, insists on listening to more, fast-forwarding it to the exact moment the professor begins reciting the incantation to summon the evil Kandarian demons.
Tatir mano mansizon hazan sobar.
Cheryl takes this well, in that she has a complete meltdown and flees the room, but whatever. Ash, eager to get something going with his girlfriend, Linda, gives her the ugliest necklace I have ever seen. She seems genuinely impressed, though. I guess it's one of those late 70s, early 80s things. Cripes, you can even tell the thing is spray-painted. Some unseen force is watching them from outside, and even it isn't buying this phony impressed act, as it goes hunting for something a bit more entertaining. It comes across Cheryl, alone in her room, and does its best to lure her out.
Oh yeah, like that's gonna work. Trust me, as a guy who's tried lots better lines with horrible results, the best you can expect here is complete success in her pajamas? What the hell? Okay, this girl deserves whatever's coming to her. Damn it. Alright, let me address this, okay? This scene is known as the tree rape scene. And for good reason. The idea during filming, in the script it was just put down, Cheryl gets attacked by the trees. The idea during filming was to hurt the audience as much as possible, and it is truly an unpleasant, unsettling scene to watch. Director Sam Raimi has said himself that he regrets putting this scene in the movie and letting it go that far. And that's the guy who let this in one of his movies. So he knows a thing or two about regret.
Is it gone?
Cheryl makes a direct route to the cabin, as one would under the circumstances, and explains the situation to her friends, who, of course, don't believe her. She finally convinces Ash to take her back into town, and, after some brief car troubles, the two are on their way. Except for that bridge being out. That kind of throws a wrench into the works. They get back to the house, where no one else seems to be bothered by the bridge being completely ripped up. I mean, look at the thing! It's not like a branch fell on it or something. The whole thing has been violently twisted out of shape, and Linda and Shelley decide to do card tricks, which Cheryl ends up being better at anyways.
Four of hearts, eight of spades, two of spades, jack of diamonds, jack of clubs!
All right, and now she's possessed. During this phase, she threatens the entire cabin, stabs Linda in her super realistic looking leg, knocks a cheap bookshelf on top of Ash, which he handles about as well as the chosen one in his tiny net, and bitch slaps Scotty. Scotty doesn't take too kindly to this, though, and he knocks her into the basement so hard she turns into a cheap department store mask. He locks her in, because the vicious beast that just managed to skewer someone's ankle on a dull pencil and bitch slap two full-grown men clear across the room just can't seem to break through some old, worn wood. She watches from her new digs as Ash, Scotty, and Shelley debate what to do next, until Shelley has a minor meltdown about the state of Cheryl's eyes.
Eyes!
Yeah, because if I saw a good friend of mine go from this to this to this in under an hour, my reaction would be, wow, her eyes look weird.
Shelley, in her eye-related despair, gets a bit paranoid, which leads Scotty, a super sympathetic and totally understanding boyfriend, to send her off to bed. Alone. Where she is promptly attacked. Scotty investigates with all the passion and general unease of someone who has just misplaced the remote control. He checks the bathroom, which totally doesn't have shower curtains taped to the wall for some odd reason, when Shelley pops up and smears red finger paint down Scotty's face before hopping on for a sweet makeout sesh. Because these demons are here for lovin'. Scotty isn't into that, though, and so he chucks his girlfriend into the fire, watching her burn and scream in agony for a few seconds before deciding he might as well drag her out. Possessed Shelley reveals that Scotty fell for the old, "Ouch, this fire really hurts" trick, and attacks him again. She backhands Ash as he falls into another bookcase, which he handles with all the grace he did the last one. Christ, Superman didn't struggle this much with a necklace. All the while, by the way, Shelley is pounding at the basement door, unable to get it open. Truly terrifying villains we have here. Shelley tries to stab Scotty with that spooky knife we all totally forgot existed, but Scotty grabs his own knife, slicing at Shelley's totally real, not at all prosthetic hand. She proceeds to chew the rest of the rubber appendage off as Scotty and Ash just watch.
Please,
Despite it taking a good long while, and giving them ample opportunity to either attack or flee, Shelly finally succeeds, dropping the knife, at which point Scotty springs into action, grabbing the spooky knife and stabbing his girlfriend in the back, resulting in what has to be one of the longest death screams I have ever heard. So she's down and out, only not really. She springs back up for one last scare, though Ash, with his death grip on the axe, is too scared to put down a former friend. So Scotty, being the dedicated boyfriend, hacks her to bits. Then, with the help of the cowardly butt whistle, buries her and heads back inside to formulate a new plan, which is to abandon the one non-possessed woman in the group and run through the woods in the hopes they can find a trail. Ash, growing the backbone he would later become known for, refuses, and Scotty departs. Ash looks in on his girlfriend, whose ankle wound from earlier isn't looking so hot. The evil creeps in through it, possessing the last female in the movie, though all it does is make her giggle and shriek, so she's only slightly more threatening than the one locked in the cellar.
Though we are more than an hour into the movie, and the most threatening villain we have so far is the one giggling like me when I get free ice cream.
Oh. So we're really not going to count it as a win on the movie's part.
Ash flees, only to find Scotty making his return, a little worse off than when he left just over a minute ago. Considering how the forest treated Cheryl, I'm surprised it took him this long to get back. As the dynamics shift a bit, we're left with the boy who got owned by a bookshelf twice as our main hero. He slaps around his mortally wounded best friend until he reveals a glimmer of good news.
Is there a way around the bridge?
There's a way. The trail.
Unfortunately, the demonic giggling from Linda and Cheryl apparently worsens Scotty's condition. This leads Ash to smack around his girlfriend briefly, which doesn't do anything to sour her mood. At Scotty's barely coherent encouraging, Ash threatens to shoot Linda, which was, I guess, the magic word all along, as both she and Cheryl change back into their old selves. Shelly isn't so lucky, but maybe that's for the best. Or it could have all been a trick. Cheryl can punch through the floor now, though that pesky door is still keeping her contained.
Yay, continuity.
Ash flexes his acting muscles.
Oh, you bastards! Why are you torturing me like this? Why?
Linda changes back too, and has built up her game from giggling to creepy nursery rhymes. This is a step too far for Ash, as he drags his girlfriend outside so hard her makeup changes, and leaves her mere steps away from the door. Back inside, Ash manages to pour some water down Scotty's throat and murmur some encouraging words before realizing his good buddy is dead. This has distracted him just long enough for Linda to have snuck up behind him with creepy knife, giving Ash a flesh wound before taking the time for a nice refreshing snack. To Ash's credit, he does manage to stay away from any bookshelves this time around, wrestling the knife away to stab Linda in the back. Ash contemplates hacking his girlfriend up with a chainsaw, but the sight of the hideous necklace from earlier snaps him out of it. So he decides that just burying her should do the trick. It doesn't, of course. One quick beheading later, though, and she's down for the count. Ash makes his way back inside, figuring the worst is behind him. only to find Cheryl has finally managed to burst her way out of the basement. He manages to get a quick shot off on her from the window, verifying she is, in fact, outside. He therefore decides to barricade himself inside. He doesn't bother locking the doors or anything, though, as Cheryl seems to have a difficult time with doors anyways. Finding himself low on ammo, Ash ventures into the basement, only to have a spoof of all things, the Three Stooges, as the house itself decides to mess with him. Undeterred, Ash gets what he came for, retreating back upstairs. Here, through admittedly awesome cinematography, we witness Ash descending into paranoia and madness. The use of Dutch angles and unconventional framing does create a genuine feeling of uncertainty and an overall uncomfortable tone. With Ash throwing away his hard-earned ammunition on passing shadows and screaming at small things like banging shutters, before convincing himself to calm down by looking to the ugly necklace for comfort, just in time for Cheryl to punch through the door and Scotty's lifeless corpse to come back to life. Scotty beats Ash around a bit before Ash gets the upper hand, incapacitating his old friend just in time for Cheryl to finally figure out the door. As she beats him with a fire poker, Ash attempts to use the necklace to latch onto the book that one would be fully forgiven for forgetting all about. At the absolute last second, Ash manages to snag the book, tossing it into the fire, thereby stopping the possessed remains of his former pals in an explosion of impressive budget claymation and sound effects. With a final murmur,
"Join us."
The evil seems to be gone for good. Ash leaves the cabin as the sun rises, the music swells, roll credits. Oh, right after the evil, which has apparently been staring at a leaf on the ground, reawakens and attacks Ash, who screams like a little girl. Now, roll credits. So that's the original Evil Dead. Low budget, obvious fake effects, really mediocre acting, and I friggin' love this movie. I do. It's just not Halloween without it. To me, Evil Dead is to Halloween what a Charlie Brown Christmas is to Christmas. It's just not Halloween without it. The idea is to be scared, to be made uneasy, to cringe, and above all, to not take it all too seriously. The remake, released a couple years ago, was good. Surprisingly good. Really. But it lacked the original's raw energy and slightly funny edge. Although the sequels, Evil Dead 2, Dead by Dawn, and Army of Darkness, were fun, this will always be my favorite. It does everything that a horror movie should, and is rock-solid proof that low-budget and inexperienced actors are no reason to turn in a bad movie. I'm the Geek with the Gab, and if you'll excuse me, I got some haunting to do.